things that we can do to stop these fire yards from coming is absurd. There's nothing that we can do to stop the fiery darts from being leveled against us. We have to understand, though, we do not have to let them penetrate our lives. That's
right.
That's the difference.
A few years ago, I taught New Testament survey at my previous school, and the particular textbook, it may have been Unger's textbook about New Testament survey, but he brought out something that I've never forgotten about fiery darts, is the enemy, you know, if we go back to the ancient Near East and warfare, we have spears, we have swords, bows and arrows, we have no machine guns, no missiles. So they strategically would shoot fiery darts from every direction. And part of it was we thought the enemy's over here, but then behind us they're shooting them. They want those darts to come in different angles to not only cause fear, but to cause confusion and panic. And panic in the person's life. So many times as a Christian, do we get hit with something and we first panic? And then we're just confused. We're like, Lord, I have my faith in the cross of Christ. I have my faith in the right object. I'm trusting in you and your finished work at Calvary. Why am I getting hit from the side here with this attack that seems to come out of nowhere? And it's easy for us to panic, and it's easier for us to be confused. I've been there. I've thrown up my hands and said, Lord, I'm doing everything I think I'll have. I said, Lord, why is this happening? Being real with God, we go, Lord, this isn't fair. Of course, as if we were to tell God what's fair, you know, but I think we've all been there. These fiery darts are more than, obviously, a flaming arrow is going to inflict a lot of damage, but it's not just being rained down on by these darts, but they're coming from all directions. And I've been there, what I felt like, Lord, I've been attacked on all directions.
It's that saying that we've been attacked on all sides.
Yeah.
Temptation is always going to be in the life for everyone. It doesn't matter how holy you may be or how consecrated you are to the Lord. We're always going to be tempted. But the key is, as we looked at, is the faith, having that shield of faith. And we have that foundation of the proper faith, the faith of Christ, the faith of the Son of God. Whenever we, I'm going to break you in a minute, but whenever we look at the word faith in the New Testament, again, it always points back to Christ. That's biblical faith.
That's biblical faith, you know, and whenever you think about it, I think we also have to understand, too, that God allows the devil a certain latitude.
Of course he does. Right.
When it comes to us.
Right. Right.
When it comes to his people. Why? There's several reasons. One of them I really think is, it's really to teach us to trust and depend upon him, more so than anything. But the reality is God allows Satan latitude. And there's going to be times where it feels like God is allowing more latitude, giving Satan more latitude to inflict these temptations upon us to where we feel like we're being hit from all sides. And at times, there's going to be that statement where we go back to the Word and we say, Lord, you said in your Word that you wouldn't put things on us more than what we can bear. But yet, it feels like you are. And there is some confusion there. There is some oppression that is there. But the reality is this, is that there's always a reason why God allows these things. My grandfather made a statement, and he didn't coin this, I don't think, but he may have. I don't think he did. He may have got it from somebody who got it from somebody who got it from somebody who got it from somebody going down the line. But he made the statement, and all of us need to understand this, faith must be tested. But great faith must be tested, great faith. And you can deal with it. Brother Dave, when we ministered at Family Worship Center 2 months ago, trying to encourage us to
that's what James said. He said that we are tempted when we're drawn away from lust. I think a lot of times we neglect to recognize what is in us that has a tendency to really be the catalyst for the temptation and even falling into that temptation.
Okay, Caitlin, so just real quick, let's dive into that for a moment. Yeah, go ahead. Pull out the passage if you can. Let's look at it. James chapter 1.
James chapter 1.
It's verse 13.
You got it. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempts him with good. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lusts and enticed. The notes right there says the temptation to sin appeals to a moral defect in us, even in the best, for none are perfect. So to take a look at that term, moral defect,
which we all have.
And it's different for everyone. You know, there could be some that it could be, and I'm just using this as an example. There could be some, it's their mouth.
Right.
In others, it's what they see. You know, in others, it's themselves, their pride,
right,
their ego, their arrogance.
We all have a bit of that manifests itself in different ways, but it's all the same. It's all
right.
A result of their evil, lustful passions that we all have as a result of our sin nature. You know, it's interesting also to see here, when we look at these men, tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Look at the progression here. That when lust has conceived,
surrender.
It's just completely
surrender.
That's
without the
learning, that's was the struggle and is the struggle for me, learning how to stop working and start resting and what Christ has already done. So my heart as a teenager, as a young man, was, man, that thought is not cleared the land. Taking authority over those thoughts that enter in, but I didn't understand how to have the power to resist that. That shield of faith that is directly within our faith being in the cross of Christ.
That's what we quench, those arrows is what they are. Another passage we could look at is, I think it's 1 Corinthians 10:13, and I have that right, that says, most of you would know this, no temptation has taken you but such as is common to man, but God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you can bear, but along with that temptation, He will provide a way for you to stand up on the way of escape. The way of escape is Calvary.
That's right.
That's the way of escape that He's provided.
The biggest thing I think that Christians face, or one of the biggest things that Christians face, is that whole, this idea right here of not allowing temptation to take root.
Yeah.
It's there,
right,
but it's not allowing. It's not.
We've got to understand that. You know, so many Christians, they get under condemnation when they're tempted.
Yeah.
Yes.
Man, I can't believe I was tempted to go in that direction, or I thought that. Man, welcome to humanity. You know, thank you.
this size and trying to, you know, stop those fiery darts. It's like you're hiding behind that TV on all four sides. On top, this side, and behind you. Well, it's all five sides. Then one, two, three, four sides, five sides on top. It's like you are in Christ. Your faith is in what he has accomplished. But the idea is this, and I feel like this can be a little bit of a problem too. Once you get past the first temptation, there is that proclivity for some of us to say, I got this now. I got it now. I got it. And that's whenever you run into a brick wall. This is something that needs to be done daily. How many times have you heard us say, every single day, every day, every day, throughout the day, as much as you can throughout the day, Lord, I place my faith in what you've done for me at Calvary's cross. That is the only way for these temptations not to be allowed to come in or take hold. Because the idea, really the seriousness is, temptations are going to come, but you don't have to allow them to take root, and you go through. You don't have to. This is where your faith must be a solid foundation.
It's kind of another passage that just kind of came to mind in 1 Peter chapter 5. Peter said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour.
Right.
Resist steadfast in the faith. That's the key. That's the faith, living by the faith of the Son of God.
That is so important for us to understand. And listen, I get it. Let me touch on this for a second. And I'm going to go back. The whole idea that living for God is easy. Once you finally clue in to everything. My grandfather made a statement. I was talking to him one time. We were discussing this very thing. It was something that came up in a conversation. And to be honest with you, I think we were either at my house or we were at his house. I don't remember. It was one or the other. We live right next door to each other. And many times, you know, I should say many times, almost every day, they come over to my house. And, you know, or I'll go over to theirs. But anyway, it was at some point in the conversation, my grandfather made that statement that you made a few months ago at Family Worship. And I'll be honest with you, I think when you made that statement, it caught everybody's by surprise. Honestly, when you can read the room and look at the room, I think there are people like, what is he talking about? No, it's not. But if you heard what your grandfather was saying behind you, he was like, yes, it is. Yes, it is. And he made that statement. He said, Gabriel, living for God, if you really understand the finished work of Christ, and you have an understanding of what he's done for you, and you realize the fullness of it, the fruitfulness of it, he said this, he said, living for God is easy, but we mess it up 99 to 100% of the time, 100% of the time, we mess it up because we cannot seem to get past ourselves. That's the key. We cannot get past ourselves. The greatest hindrance to us living for God many times is really not Satan. It's us. We cannot get out of our own way. We cannot get out of our own way. And it goes back to what Brother as easy.
Your grandfather, who studied the word, since I was
gentlemen, and Brother Dave, you added one more thing during that break, and I feel like it's a good
thing. I just brought up this reality that many Christians don't seem to realize, just how we have to recognize how bad off we really are. The depth of our depravity, the extent of our sinfulness, and not to bring condemnation, but truly when we understand that, we really have a revelation of just really how messed up we are. As you said, Brother Swagger always say, we're swirled up, we're always swirled up. When you have a revelation of that, then it really puts you in a position now to really begin to walk in the revelation of the cross and of the solution. So, point being this, is most Christians, we cover ourselves with fig leaves. We make like our sin, our situation, our sinfulness is not as bad as it really is, but it's bad.
It's bad.
Jesus said, out of the heart of man proceeds
wickedness, murder, fornication, adultery, fornication.
I used to, when I was a young Christian, I'd look at failure and I would look at sin, kind of with a self-righteous judgmental mentality. And I would do that as a Christian. think that's either. But now I've gotten to the point where I'm keeping the break on when I see fear, when I see me, when I see adultery, when I see fornication, when I see envy, strife, jealousy, any sin that there is in the book, when I see
take his dumb ass.
That God will do that with us, we must not do that. to our brothers and sisters in Christ.
That's why, you know, Paul in Galatians chapter 6, when he said, you who are spiritual,
yes,
store such a one, who is overtaking you upon me. He said this, he said, do it in the spirit of meekness, lest you also be tempted. So with the mindset of recognizing that, again, as you said, except for the grace of God, I would be there too. I'm no better than you.
I'm no better than anybody else. But here's another thing Jesus said for us regarding the Beatitudes. Blessed are you. Blessed are those who treat people with kindness, who restore people, who will work with people, who will help those, who will practice forgiveness. That we have to, I think that the church has lost sight of these things. And we're very good at building people up, only to watch them and only to tear them down. And whenever we tear them down, we don't like to build them back up again. We discard them and say, you're done. But God never does that with anyone. Not only does He build us up, but when we are taken with a fault and we make a mistake, God is always there to build us back up as long as we only believe. If we continue to pursue the faith, pursue the cross of Christ, pursue Calvary, pursue Christ Himself, He's always going to be there to restore us.
Aren't you glad that God is about restoration?
Yes.
And about restoration? Where would we be? And why? I hope that in my ministry that I endeavor to be someone of restoration, someone of redemption, because that's where we all are. We may not have been taken by a fault that's public, but we've all needed the grace of God. We were all in sin, and we've all fallen short of the glory of God. So this high and mighty, holier-than-thou attitude that some people have about this is a man, you know, that grew up in the grace of God. Where would you be? So hopefully we're about redemptive leadership and obviously, sin is very serious. We take it very seriously. It costs Jesus. Jesus had to go to Calvary because of it. I mean, it's very, very serious. But thankfully, the Lord is a God of restoration. And when we get on the mark, we can come
out. I love saying this. I've been thinking about this a lot. I can't speak for the rest of the world. I can just speak for our country. Our country is built on comeback stories.
Yeah.
Our country is built on comeback stories. We love comeback stories. Everyone who's had a job of God is a comeback story in one sense or the other. Whether or not in a public arena or in a private arena, we're all a comeback story. Because if we don't quit believing, if our faith, if we never lose sight, if we never let go of that shield of faith, we never let go. It may falter out of our hands sometimes. If we're able to pick it back up and readjust and make sure and replant that our faith is ever anchored in what Jesus Christ has done, even though we've made that mistake, that our faith is still anchored in who He is and what He's done, God's going to pick us back up. And He's going to build us up once again. And I think we should be celebrating comeback stories and not celebrating defeats. But the church celebrates defeats, and we don't like comeback stories.
Why is it that we can be so self-righteous and so judgmental and so unaware of our own failure and our own sin? You know, the only thing that I can, the only conclusion that I can come up with is that, again, the heart, the deceitfulness of the heart, is we are deceived in thinking that that's not us, that we are better than the next
person. Wouldn't you say that it's
deceit?
Wouldn't you say that it's a form of pride?
Well, sure, yeah.
That's really what it boils down to, is we're so proud,
yeah,
that that's not us.
Yeah.
But we will never, ever allow someone to look into our hearts to see the skeleton of our closet.
Right.
We keep those well.
Exactly.
So we will stop at nothing to tear people down whenever their skeletons get out of their closet.
Yeah, it goes back to the same thing, you know, we look at and we fail, we sin, we think we just cover up with fig leaves and God can't see it.
Yeah. And we know that others can't see it.
Right.
Yeah,
that's what we, I think we're more concerned with other, what other
right,
people
exactly,
think,
yeah,
instead of what God says and God knows. And so, once again, as we come down to the close of today's program, I want you to understand something. Number one, if you yourself have been in one of those moments where you've allowed temptation to seep in, and you made a mistake, I want you to understand something. There is a way of escape. We're not judging you for that. We're not knocking you for that. All of us have made our share, our fair share of mistakes. Here's the key. Don't quit. Keep your faith anchored in Christ, who He is and what He's done, because there's going to come a day when that thing is not going to bother you. There may be that temptation, but you're not going to allow it to seep in and to take root and to land in the heart of your life. Keep your faith anchored. Keep a hold of that shield of faith. Don't let it take root. To do so, keep your faith anchored in what Jesus Christ has done. Don't lose sight of the ultimate goal, which is Christ. Christ in us, the hope of glory. Keep your faith anchored in who He is and what He's done. I promise you, as we talked about it, it's going to come a time when you're going to realize, hey, this is easy. His burden is easy, or His yoke is easy, and His burden is light. We love you. God bless you.
Love you too.
See you next time. Thanks for joining us.
All I want and see, and it's Jesus Christ and the crucified.